हेलो फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज़ रोशनी शाह एंड वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल नर्सिंग स्टडी एक्सपर्ट। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट आइसोलेशन प्रिकॉशन। इन्फेक्शन कंट्रोल इज़ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग दैट वी हैव टू फॉलो इन द हॉस्पिटल प्रोटोकॉल्स। सो मोस्ट ऑफ द नर्सेज गेट्स कन्फ्यूज बिटवीन एयरबॉर्न प्रिकॉशन एंड ड्रॉपलेट प्रिकॉशन एंड दिस टॉपिक इज़ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर योर एनक्लेक्स टू। So today we are going to discuss about what is standard precaution, what is transmission based precaution. Diseases are required, which precautions, which PPEs we have to wear. So if you are a new watcher, don't forget to subscribe my channel. And if you have already subscribed my channel, please press the bell icon below so you will get notified whenever I will put a new video. And if you like my video, don't forget to like, comment and share with your friends. So let's get started. First of all, standard precaution. Standard precaution is the basic level of precautions that we have to use for the take care of all patients. And it is the basic level of infection control practices that everyone should use in the hospital. Standard precaution includes hand hygiene and wearing PPE as per the need. Hand hygiene includes hand washing and using of hand sanitizer. Wash your hands with the soap and water whenever it is visibly soiled or contaminated. And wash the hands before touching the patient, before doing any procedure, after touching the patient, and after doing any procedure, and after touching patient's surrounding, because the droplets can be on the surrounding areas or surrounding articles of the patient and it can get transmitted from the infected person to you. So wash your hands after touching the patient's surrounding, and if you are coming in a direct contact with the patient, wear gloves. If there is a chances of splashing of body fluids, wear gown and mask. So, the standard precautions are the basic level of precautions that we use to protect ourselves from blood, body fluids and mucus of infected person. So, what is transmission based precaution? It can be airborne precaution, droplet precaution, or it can be contact precaution. The airborne precaution and droplet precautions can be transmitted through respiratory droplets. The respiratory droplets, if they are smaller in size, it can travel far in the air and it will be inhaled through person. So it is seen in airborne precaution. If the respiratory droplets are bigger in the size, it can travel up to 3 feet and it can inhale by a person, or it can transmit it through eyes, nose and mouth, which is seen in droplet precaution. So which diseases are transmitted through airborne precaution? First of all, chickenpox, also known as varicella, then TB, or it can be disseminated herpes zoster, also known as shingles. And it occurred in an immunocompromised patient with a history of chickenpox. Or it can be measles, rubella. Chickenpox and disseminated herpes zoster patients will be on contact precautions as well. So the airborne precaution people needs a single private room with a negative air pressure and 6 to 12 air exchanges. So the air coming from a special source inhaled by a patient and exhaled air goes through a special source, and doors should be closed. Anyone entering into the room should wear a particulate N95 mask and it should be removed just upon the exit. While transferring the patient has to wear a simple surgical mask. Next, droplet precaution. So in the droplet precaution, the respiratory droplets are bigger in the size and it can travel up to 3 feet. So anyone with the same condition can stay in one room with a minimum of 3 feet distance. So either single private room or same condition patient with 3 feet distance. And there is no requirement of any specific air filters or any air pressures. Doors can remain open and person has to wear a simple surgical face mask. While transferring the patient, patient has to wear a simple surgical face mask. And you need to warn the area that patient is having a droplet precaution. And the droplet diseases are transmitted through eyes, nose and mouth. So you have to take special precautions while giving oral care or suctioning. You have to wear a mask and goggles as well. So which diseases require droplet precaution? The mnemonic to remember droplet precaution is Spider-Man. S stands for scarlet fever. Scarlet fever is a streptococcal infection which is seen in a child. Child will have rashes all over the body, fever and a sore throat. P stands for pertussis, pharyngitis, pneumonia and parvovirus. So basically most of the upper respiratory tract infection except tuberculosis will require droplet precaution. So the pertussis is also known as a whooping cough. Pertussis is transmitted through cough, sneeze, saliva or skin-to-skin contact. Next, I stands for influenza. Then D. D stands for diphtheria. Diphtheria is an emergency condition seen in a child where there will be a whitish color patch over the pharynx and child will have airway obstruction. Diphtheria affects nose and throat. Child will have runny nose, sore throat, difficulty in the breathing and coughing. E stands for epiglottitis. Epiglottitis is the infection and inflammation of the epiglottis. It is also an emergency condition where child will have drooling, coughing, difficulty in swallowing and respiratory distress. And it can be preventable with HIV vaccine. Now next R. R stands for rubella and roseola. Rubella is also known as German measles. It is a viral infection and it spreads through direct contact of a saliva or mucous membrane of infected person or a respiratory droplets produced from cough and sneeze. M stands for mumps. It is a viral infection that affects respiratory tract and it spreads through saliva of an infected person. A stands for adenovirus, where patient will have flu-like symptoms, fever, cough, pneumonia, bronchitis, and it spreads through respiratory droplets produced from coughing and sneezing. So this is the droplet precaution where doors can be open, patient will require a single room or a twin sharing room with the same condition. And at least 3 feet distance is required. And patient will need only a simple surgical face mask. Now next is the contact precaution. What is contact precaution? Contact diseases are the diseases that are transmitted through direct or indirect contact of a person or something that a person have touched. And the contact precautions will require a hand washing with soap and water and wearing PPE as per the need. So I already told you that you have to wash your hands before touching the patient, before doing any procedure, after doing any procedure and after touching the patient and after touching patient's surrounding. And if you are coming in a direct contact with the patient, wear gloves and if there is a chances of splashing of body fluid, wear mask and goggles as well as gown. So patient will require a single private room or two same condition patients can stay in a room. All the equipment that is used by the patient will remain in the client's room. And now which diseases require contact precaution? First of all, medication resistant diseases such as MRSA, insulin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. It is a bacterial infection which is resistant to all the antibiotics except vancomycin. Next to VRE. It is vancomycin resistant enterococcus. It is a bacterial infection which is resistant to antibiotic vancomycin. Now next is the diarrheal infection, such as E. coli, C. difficile, rotavirus, norovirus, pinworm, Shigella, Salmonella and Giardiasis. And hepatitis A and E is also transmitted through orofecal route. So hepatitis A and E also requires contact precaution. Some skin infections also require contact precaution, such as impetigo, lice, scabies, herpes simplex, skin diphtheria and shingles. Impetigo is a group B streptococcal infection where child will have honey color lesions over the face and it spreads through touch. Wound infection with excessive drainage also requires contact precaution. And the respiratory infection such as RSV, respiratory syncytial virus. It is an infection seen in a child and child will have thick tenacious nasal sputum, productive cough and fever. So the RSV patients require a single private room and RSV nurse cannot take care of any other patients. All the equipments that is used by this patient will remain in the patient's room. And the bacterial and allergic conjunctivitis will also require contact precaution. So the contact precaution will require a hand washing and wearing PPE as per the need. Either the single room or the same condition patient can stay in a room. So that wraps up our session here of the isolation precaution. I hope guys you understood this. I tried to make it very simple for you. And please feel free to give feedback in the comment section below about the video. Thanks for the watching. If you are liking my video, don't forget to like, comment and share with your friend. If you are a new watcher, please subscribe my channel and press the bell icon below so that you will get notified whenever I will put a new video.